The guy has been at corporate strategy at IBM for quite a long time. He joined Media Brands in May 2011. And he will be talking about the ultimate question, how technology enables pay for performance. So no more words, let's get the guy up on stage. Please welcome the CTO of Media Brands, Mr. Dr. Hagen Wenzek.
Thanks. Gestern sind meine Kollegen ganz nervös geworden, als Joe Grosser von der Allianz angefangen hat, seine Einführung in Deutsch zu halten. Diesmal, glaube ich, wechsle ich relativ früh auf Englisch, damit die Kollegen nicht so nervös werden. So welcome, I'm Hagen Wenzek, I'm Chief Technology Officer of IPG Media Brands. We're the media holding company within IPG. And at Media Brands, I'm looking after technology, trying to make sure that technology is really enabling both effectiveness and efficiency when it comes to delivering marketing services. My boss, Matt Seiler, who was until I think 2 days ago on the agenda, was meant to talk about everything from pay for performance, real-time data and dashboards, and how to save the world. I think I'm skipping the last one and focus on the first three. That's a little bit more my core competency here. And when we're looking at that, those three topics really combine together, form what we call the value of now. Capturing that value of now, means finding the right audience, finding the right audience with the right message, and finding the right audience with the right message at the right time. I think that's pretty much the white elephant that we're all chasing, that we're all trying to capture, and they all really come together through technology. So the ability to deliver that technology now got IT a seat on the table. So it's now that I see this happening around a couple of our clients, finally, that we find IT having a seat on the table, or maybe on the stage, like myself right now. So a couple of examples. On Tuesday, just before I came over here, over in New York, I was at a pitch for a very large beverage holding company. And they were looking for a global portfolio management of all of their media spend. And half of the room was full with IT people. Great story. 2 weeks ago, over at the IPG Media Lab, our lab in New York City, we had one of the largest German car manufacturer over. And they were looking to brainstorm what are new ideas to connect consumers better to car dealers. They brought their US CIO. Great story as well. But then the opposite is also true. A couple of weeks ago, or is it now a month already? I think it was 2 months. We had a very, very large global pitch for all media, for a CPG company, and IT was nowhere to be seen. Last year, another global pitch, one of the largest car manufacturers. No IT anywhere, neither during the pitch, in the room, nor in preparation before. And afterwards, they even fired the CIO, who was trying to come much closer to marketing and really start enabling and bringing the value of IT and technology into everything that that matters for marketing. So we have that seat on the table, but change is really only happening the moment that we start to see pay for performance that is changing the way that we actually do business. And that's the changing agency business model that changes how we are being compensated. Today we are compensated typically with retainers, project fees, commissions, and that is rather preventive to do good technology investments because very often you invest into the technology to become more efficient that generates fewer fees. Fewer fees? If you invest, doesn't really make sense. So the idea here is to move towards pay for performance. That means we're getting paid for the performance we deliver and not that the effort that we put into the project or into our services. And if we do that, then it's much easier to put investments into automation, for example, into data analysis, etc. Pay for performance comes in a couple of other words as well, often value-based pricing, outcome-based pricing, value-based compensation, VPC, what Gartner calls it. And Gartner just did a nice study here. Andrew Frank worked with us to try to figure out what does it mean to do pay for performance, who is doing it already and who is not doing it. And he says that today it's just 4% of the industry that is actually covered through pay for performance contracts or value-based compensation contracts. And don't be fooled that that is only in our industry the case. So as you just heard in the introduction, I spent a long career over at IBM. Like most of my time as a consultant, doing a lot of e-business implementations, supply chain management stuff for the consumer industries, then also as a thought leader and later in corporate strategy over in Amok, New York. And we were pushing really hard to also for IBM establish outcome-based pricing contracts. At some point in time, we found that we were struggling to document more than really one case. A couple of years ago, before I left, there was one case that was strong enough to be published to talk about that is outcome-based pricing. That was for an Indian telecommunications company, Bharti, that is now the most successful telco mobile phone provider over in India. And IBM got only paid whenever a new subscriber was actually brought on board. And then IBM would put in new technology to enable that subscriber on top of the network. Very much directly coupled outcome, input, how much investments goes into it, how much do you get paid? So Andrew over at Gartner estimates that for the media entertainment industry, within the next 5 years, we're going to see maybe 10% of all the contracts being covered via pay for performance. That means a lot of pressure on technology, because technology at the end that makes it happen. Well, if you're looking at IPG Media Brands, we're actually already doing like half, so 50% of all of our contracts of the client base is covered with pay for performance. Talk about pressure on IT. So what is it that makes pay for performance successful? What's now behind it? What's the beef? So first of all, we're seeing that data, we're talking about data the whole time here, data is it what represents the financial relationship of that business model, of that relationship between the marketeer and the marketing agencies. It is data that fundamentally changes that relationship. And it does so because data creates a lot of transparency, and data also documents a lot of the value that is being created. And so if you think of that transparency and of the data that is starting to show what is actually happening, what the performance is, then you are actually coming together and trying to pursue a common goal. Because at the end, what you want to do is really to have both the marketing agencies and the marketeers being measured on the same things, pursue a common goal. That's the ideal normal change, normal thing. But if the incentives, if the financials behind it are not aligned, then pursuing a common goal is actually pretty tricky and often just coincidental or happens because of some other motivation to also address a goal. But if it's not the financials, we are often in trouble. So working towards a common goal is very, very critical. And a common goal coupled with the data means finding the right measurements. Finding the right measurements that document then also these goals. Measurements where we're looking at measuring input, output, and the process in between, or the many, many processes in between. And then you're coming to a stage where you can say, this is a goal that is documented via maybe KPIs, and the measurements actually make it happen. I'm an engineer, so in Germany, engineers have a saying, they're missed, missed, missed. Somebody who's trying to measure often measures crap. And so we want to be careful to figure out what are the measurements that actually do make a lot of sense. So it's about measurement itself, but also finding the right measures is somewhat the art. The other one is just the technique behind it. So technology is what's making that real. But just technology in itself doesn't really make it real, else we would already be there, because we have a lot of technology. But you're running around this whole conference, and you're trying to find the technology that makes this all possible. And usually you don't, because for especially marketing agencies, media agencies, the right approach to technology, where you're matching your own core competencies, like the media core competencies, and on the other side, the core competencies of partners, is when it all comes together. And take, for example, MAP, the Media Brands Audience Platforms, which we launched for Germany this morning. Brendan Moorcroft out here. We had our public launch, where we now brought MAP, that has been established already a couple of years ago in the US, now across the world, and finally, in Cologne and Rhineland, we're starting to find MAP as well. And MAP establishes programmatic buying for display, search, social, mobile. And what is different about MAP is that Brendan and his team are really good in identifying the right partners. Having a slim, lean, but proprietary and very insightful platform, a little bit IP that is distinct, but what is most important is that this platform is connected to those companies that do a lot of the technology themselves. Those are the companies that are building out new innovations in social listening. They're building out new innovations in analytics engines. They're building new innovation in big data. That spans everything from the usual suspects, the DSPs like Turn, over into the very large companies like IBM, my old employer. Bring them to the table to make sure that we get also large data being connected, or Microsoft, and getting them to provide the stack underneath. But selecting these partners and plugging them together, that's the secret sauce that makes MAP special. It is not the depth of the technology, it's the breadth of the knowledge of what you're really bringing together here. So, sounds all good? Sounds easy? Well, not so much. That's why I put a complicated chart on. That's out of the new white paper that Andrew Frank published, where I just got you the quote as well. And he and I, we worked on developing a maturity model and trying to figure out what does it take to actually start from this retainer FTE-based compensation model, and what does that mean for technology, or how should technology enable that, all the way up towards real pay-for-performance, to real partnerships. And I encourage you to look at the paper, because it explains what is behind each of these stages, and maybe helps you if you're either within an agency to look at how that works. If you're on the partner side, which is so important for us, if you understand what we are going after and how we want to get compensated, it would be great if you can align your business model already as well, so that we can plug you into our platform. If you are charging the way that Brendan is charging with MAP, our client, then the chances that you would be a partner on that platform are much greater. So look at that to figure out what does it take. And don't get fooled, it is about stages 4 or 5 where it's really happening. Everything underneath is kind of there already. But up there, it's getting really difficult. So don't want to leave that chart where everybody's reading too long on the screen here. Talked about generally the relationship between IT and marketing. It comes down at the client to the CMO and the CIO. Those two need to be able to also agree and come together and work jointly towards a goal of better performing marketing at the end. And a couple of companies have already seen that happening. It's kind of interesting. Next week, we're actually hosting out in our lab, in our offices in New York, a conference, a small one, where we have 10 couples CMOs and CIOs from very large companies coming together, roundtable discussion, and trying to figure out how can technology influence marketing. So some are seeing it, and I expect that hopefully we're soon getting more and more of these CIOs and CMOs come jointly to pitch us as well and ask for our services. So lastly, what are the three big technologies that actually make all of this happen? What are the ingredients? So there's one that is on everybody's mind all the time, and it's cloud computing. Over at IBM, I worked on the cloud computing strategy, and I think I've got a pretty good handle to figure out what is it that you can use cloud for, but also where you should not use it, at least not for now. But generally, cloud is about buying IT as a service. It is about lowering cost, more flexibility, less complexity, unbound scalability, and I can tell you for sure it's the biggest revolution in the IT industry that we came about since client-server, since maybe 20, 25 years. And it's not just the hype, but it is about me now being on the other side, being a CIO / CTO, buying IT, for me getting IT as a service and not bothering and being worried all the time that some kind of weird patches on the server level, Windows not talking to a database and something is not happening because I have only limited resources to be sure that everything is always up to date. I'm now getting IT as a service. I'm just buying that bundled and somebody else takes care of it so we can focus, again, same story as before, on our core competencies. What are we good at? Media. We want to know technology. We want to be pretty good at technology, but we're not a technology company. The second big one of the three is the consumerization of IT. Also, one of the big bullets that you see on every conference, on every newspaper's headlines. What does it really mean, consumerization of IT? It means two things for me. It's on the one side is that every consumer can become part of a conversation with a brand. Because every consumer, you, everybody here, is totally connected to the world, to each other, and to the brands. And that obviously enables all of the conversation to happen, makes it, improves it. But on the other side, it also gives us suddenly insight and a measurement device into the performance. Talking about performance all the time, we want to measure it. One way to measure it is, for example, look at the people, literally. Literally grab your phone or grab the front-facing camera of a computer and check, are people actually watching the ad? So we did a study, and yesterday Nick Bryan, in his keynote, referenced one study that we did at Mediabrands where we found that only 63% of all impressions are actually seen, not delivered. Delivered, 100% of the impressions that we're looking at are delivered, but are actually seen. How did we do this? We ran a research study with a panel of, pretty large panel of consumers that we signed up for, and we looked at them through the front-facing camera and saw, oops, eyes are wandering away. Great that we're showing an impression and that we pay for it, but if nobody's looking at it, then it was wasted. And whole the idea here is that we're using these devices, these consumer devices, to now start measuring performance very, very objectively. And last one, I mentioned it already a number of times, data becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. So big data is kind of, for me, not a cause in itself, but it triggers big insights. It's about the insights that you're getting out of this. One comparison over at Mediabrands will be, I think, generating about a petabyte of data over the next 12 months, a real deep data. Compare that to IBM again, easy for me to make IBM examples. IBM again, where they use 250 gigabyte. That's the smallest of the hottest that you can buy right now inside of a Mac Air, I think. 250 gigabytes they used to beat all humans at Jeopardy. You know the machine? It's called Watson. It used 250 gigabytes, not more. We're not talking about for petabytes and not about data that is just coming together from movie screens or something that just generate a lot. No, no, actual impression level measurements of data that we're capturing. So imagine 4,000 times more data what we can do if we can apply the right tools and if we are going after the right targets as well. So it's all great if you deliver that insight and if you do a lot of that automatically, but what you also want to do is you want to present it in a way that you can make effective decisions. And over at the already mentioned a number of times, IPG Media Lab, run by Quentin George, we created this CMO desk, which is basically the control center to performance. We want to see how are things performing, what is happening. We want to give that as a tool to the CMO and his team so that they can measure performance the same way that we are measuring performance. We're looking at it, making the right decision so that performance continues to be increased. So when it all works and comes together, then we're seeing systems, technology, IT, systems working hand in hand with experts. It's when we have workflow management systems that automate a lot of these repetitive, low-value tasks, and we have tools in place that enable the experts to create higher value. That's when this all comes together. And if it does, then we're able to do what we're supposed to do, and that is make brands matter more. And it's technology that I think contributes a lot to it. And if we find a way to overall, in part of our business model, get compensated for that work in a way that incentivizes us to pursue the same goals and pursue the same KPIs and measurements and targets, then we have the chance to actually put a lot of value into this now that we have been talking, and that is the headline of this presentation. Thank you very much.